Ich weiß nicht. Decision at Jordan. Part 2.
Yes. Decision at Jordan. Mm-hmm. It's a decision we all have to make individually. Be you great or small. It's a decision we have to make. And there is no good time to make it than now.
That's right.
This is the time to make that decision.
Tomorrow might be too late.
Oh yes, definitely. Let me first say thank you to our cherished viewers.
And that's right.
And especially those who are contributing to sustain this program on air. You see, one thing that all should understand, and especially Seventh-day Adventists should understand, is this. Because they claim they are the custodians of the three angels' messages. That is why I'm addressing them. The three angels of Revelation 14, we are told in scripture that they were flying in the midst of heaven.
That's right.
That means they weren't locked up in the heavens nor on the earth. They were in the midst of heaven.
That's right.
Yet their work was directed to the people here on earth. We don't see those angels with our eyes. Yes. They are just a symbol or representation of men and women who are carrying out the work that those angels are seen to be doing in the air. For that reason, those who are contributing for the sustenance of this program, mm-hmm. and the message that is coming from here, we are together represented by those angels.
That's right.
So our messages are timed, or they are timely.
That's right.
And also, they are the messages of these angels. We don't go more or further than that. We are at rest with these angels. That's the messages we are giving. So when we are preaching decision at Jordan, we are telling our viewers and all our listeners, okay. far and near, that they should heed to the call in Revelation chapter 18, verse 4. Come out of her, my people. That decision they are making.
Okay.
So in reality, that is what we are doing. Now the good news is that I've been receiving some interesting calls, and I say we thank God for that.
Okay.
Our labor is bearing fruit.
To God be the glory.
Amen. Some pastors have spoken to me. They have called me, spoken to me, and given me assurance.
Okay.
I'll not disclose them now. But these are pastors belonging to the big time churches.
Wow.
Not one man churches. These are what we call the Orthodox churches.
Okay.
Yes. They are, the Sabbath is now on their table and they are meeting over it.
That's right.
In fact, in some areas there are divisions, mm-hmm. but they just want to make sure that no one is left behind.
That one is obvious.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So the calls coming are very interesting.
To God be the
glory. And we appreciate their movement, and we pray that they should act quickly and they should be fast. Time is no more. Yes. So we are all at Jordan.
Okay.
And the decision has to be taken.
Okay. Even let me announce that you can also join us on Facebook, even if you are seated in front of your telly. Please, if you have a smartphone, go to Home Base TV on Facebook, like the program, and then share for us so that our brothers and sisters who doesn't have access to television can also have their share of this evening's program. Thank you.
Right. So we are reading from Joshua chapter 3, beginning from verse 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the verses we are reading. Verse 1 says, "And Joshua rose early in the morning, and they removed from Chittim, and came to Jordan, he and all the children of Israel.
Okay.
And lodged there before they passed over." That is verse 1. Two reads. "And it came to pass after 3 days that the officers went through the host, and they commanded the people, saying, when ye see the ark of the covenant of the Lord your God, and the priests, the Levites, bearing it, then ye shall remove from your place and go after it."
Okay.
Interestingly, then the last verse, "Yet," verse 4, "yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way heretofore." It means that when they see the ark moving, like we were saying last week,
that's right,
they should follow the ark, leave a distance. And the distance we are told should be 2,000 cubits. We'll do the conversion in a moment.
Okay.
Now, the commands are very simple. They've been there by the banks of the Jordan River, awaiting command.
That's right.
Then the instruction was, when you see the ark of the Lord your God move, when it is carried by the priests, they should follow. Simple.
Okay.
Yes. Now the distance, when I checked the other day, I said it was about 100 meters. I didn't get it right.
Okay.
I have gone to check and check well. The 2,000 cubits is about half a mile.
Wow. Or
0.8 kilometers. Mm. That's the distance between the congregation.
The ark, yes. The congregation.
Very well. That's the distance. About half a mile. Mm-hmm. And what reason was given for that distance to be maintained? It says, come not near unto it, that ye may know the way by which ye must go, for ye have not passed this way before. So it means that you are leaving that considerable distance where the ark could be visible, regardless to your position and place.
Okay.
Half a mile was enough for you to know the direction which the ark was pursuing. That was the decision they were to make. Fine. Now, relating it to our time, or applying it to our time now, according to Revelation chapter 11 and verse 19, says, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament.
Okay.
And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and earthquake and great hail. This was when the temple was opened and the ark was seen. Now we are directing the attention of our viewers to the ark of the Lord, not on this earth anymore, but into the heavens.
That's right.
We are telling our viewers that please look up to the heavens. And the Bible says in Revelation 11:19 that the temple of God was opened, and then they saw the ark of the testament. Who was standing there? Hebrews chapter 4 verse 14 to 16. It says Christ our high priest is the one standing before the ark of the covenant.
That's right.
Right? Now, in the earthly setup, the Levites were chosen to bear the ark.
That's right.
They were the priests. Good. In our generation, in our day and age, we are trying to connect the internet so that the writings can appear for our viewers.
Okay.
Now, in our day and age, now in our time, Hebrews 9:24 says, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands.
That's right.
No. But what? Which are figures of the truth, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. That's Hebrews 9:24.
Okay.
So Christ is now appearing in the heavens for us.
Okay.
Understand? He is our high priest. And he is the one bearing the ark. So we are following him. So that I want our viewers to understand that the Christ they should follow is a Christ who is bearing the ark of the covenant.
And the ark contains the Ten Commandments.
That's where we are proceeding.
Oh, okay.
Now we understand that the ark of the covenant in the Asian setup, in the earthly setup, in Exodus chapter 25 verse 22, it says, and there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seats, from between the two cherubims, which are upon the ark of the testimony.
That's right.
Of all things which I will give thee in the commandment of the children of Israel. So, on the ark of the covenant, on the ark of the covenant is the mercy seat.
That's right.
And that houses, or that contains, the presence of the living God. And that is where exactly Christ is standing.
Okay.
What is he doing? According to verse 12 of Hebrews 9, he is appearing there not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with his own blood.
Okay.
Now, what is he doing there? Appearing there with his own blood. Leviticus chapter 16, verse 16. We'll use the Old Testament structure to be explaining the new one.
Yeah, and the typology aspect of it.
Yes, exactly. So in Leviticus 16:16, it says, and ye shall make an atonement for the holy place because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of their transgressions and all their sins. That's my interest.
Okay.
So our high priest is before our God, Jehovah, atoning for my uncleanness.
That's right.
And then for my transgressions. The same thing applies to all our viewers and okay. all who believe, John 3:16. So the subject is that he is atoning for our cleanness. And not what I consider clean is what Christ is atoning for, but what God himself considers unclean and considers as transgression. That's what he's atoning for. I want our viewers to understand this very well.
That's right.
It's a serious matter. Mm-hmm. You see, Christ is before the Father with his blood to atone for my sins. The sins he is atoning for are not what I classify as sin.
That's right.
No. But what Jehovah has classified and defined as sin.
That's right.
That's what Christ is pleading for.
Or what he is atoning for.
Yes, exactly. Now, to give an example, Deuteronomy chapter 10. I'm reading from verse 1 to 5. Moses is speaking here. He says, at that time, the Lord said unto me, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first, and come up unto me into the mount, and make thee an ark of wood. And I will write, this is Jehovah speaking.
That's right.
And I will write on the tables of the words that were in the first tables which thou breakest, and thou shalt put them in the ark. So this was the instruction. And then Moses responded, and I made an ark of cheating wood, and hewed two tables of stone like unto the first, and went up into the mount, having the two tables in my hand.
Okay.
And he wrote on the tables, according to the first writing, the Ten Commandments, which the Lord spoke unto you in the mount, out of the midst of the fire, in the day of the assembly, and the Lord gave them unto me. This is Moses. He has spoken. And then in the fifth verse it says, and I turned myself and came down from the mount, and put the tables in the ark, which I had made, and there they be, as the Lord commanded me.
That's right.
So when we're saying that Christ is before the ark, he is before the ark that contains the Ten Commandments. That was the ark that divided the Jordan River. Right. And in it is the Ten Commandments. We are saying that Christ is our high priest, standing there. And just like the Levites were chosen in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 8, it's on the screen.
Okay.
Just like the Levites were chosen to bear the ark. So in John 3:16, God has given Christ to be our high priest bearing the ark.
That's right.
Simple. What is he doing there now? It's a work of what? Reconciliation. In the Old Testament structure, the high priest stood as a mediator between God and then the nation.
That's right.
In Romans chapter 5 verse 10 and 2 Corinthians 5, 18, 19. Romans 5, 10 reads, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life.
Okay.
That is the work of the high priest, reconciling us. And then in 2 Corinthians 5:18, he says, and all things are of God, who has reconciled us unto himself by Jesus Christ, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. 19, to wit, that God was in Christ, not was by him. God was in Christ.
That's right.
Reconciling the world unto himself.
That's right.
Not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Let me paraphrase this very well. That God was in Christ. I'm using John 3:16 here.
Okay.
For God so loved the world that he gave himself to us in Christ, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, Christ is standing before Jehovah, and I am at the back of Christ. So God sees me through Jesus Christ.
Oh, okay. Because you are behind him.
I'm behind him.
That's right.
Understand? That's how it is. So that's why it says Christ is the mediator between God and then man.
That's right.
So when it takes this position, when it takes this fall, the next thing that comes is that the blood speaks for me. Okay. When my name is mentioned, the blood speaks. And You see, God is so particular. In Leviticus chapter 16, verse 14, He says, when the high priest appears before the ark, he dips his finger, the forefinger, in the blood and touches the mercy seat with it 7 times.
Wow.
That means that Christ mentions my name before Jehovah
seven times
for one sin that I have committed.
Wow.
It shows how serious the business is. We are not joking here.
Mm.
So those pastors who attempt to joke with the commandments of the Lord, they should be careful. They should be very careful. One sin, if committed, is confessed by the high priest 7 times.
With blood.
With blood. What do I do here on earth? When you compare this,
you just confess your sins to him, and he is there to mediate on your behalf.
Sure. So when he says the high priest used the blood to touch the mercy seat, the mercy seat houses God. That is his appearance.
But
in the ark is the law. So when the blood is touching the ark, that means grace is redeeming me from the penalty of the law.
Okay, that is death.
Yes. Christ is not using his blood to clean or to take away the law, like they have been teaching their church members and other people. The law is in the ark, and the blood touches the ark containing the law. That is how mercy and grace are working. It is not a matter of Christ removing the law.
Let's say I've committed sin.
Yes.
The law reveals to me that I'm a sinner.
Sure.
I've broken the law.
Mm-hmm.
And the punishment thereof is death.
Fine.
But the law cannot forgive me.
No.
But rather leads me to Jesus Christ for pardon. Mm-hmm. And that is grace.
Yes.
And that does not break the commandment or throw it away.
Never.
It still stands.
It still stands.
Okay.
To tell you what you should do to get it right.
Okay.
Understand? That's why Romans 7:12 says the law is holy, it is just and good.
That's right.
Yes. And in 1 John 3:4, say whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law.
That's right.
For sin is a transgression of the law.
Correct definition.
Now it means that Christ is standing before the ark in the presence of Jehovah, pleading my transgressions. And in Proverbs 28:13, he says, he that covers his sins shall not prosper.
Prosper. That's right.
Let me explain that one very well. You have broken the law of God. And you have been told by the Bible that what you have done is transgressing and is sin. You come out and say, Paul said there is no law. Curses anyone who is under the law. Please. Paul has not said so. And even if your mind should mistakenly understand that Paul was reading the Ten Commandments, you are wrong. Whosoever breaks any of the Ten Commandments has committed sin.
That's right.
The next thing for you to do is that confess that sin and then do what? Forsake it. That is all. When you haven't done this, your sin remains on you. And Christ cannot plead for pardon because you have refused to confess it and you have refused to forsake it.
Okay.
And that is the way we commit sin against the Holy Ghost.
Okay. And gradually, it leads us to the unpardonable sin. Oh, okay.
Now, when you have understood it like this, this is the gospel in its totality.
Okay.
Mark 16:15-16. Says what? And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. This is the gospel we are preaching.
Okay.
It is not about the gospel of prosperity and so on and so forth. No. It is about believing in Jesus Christ and then yielding your will unto him so he controls you.
Okay.
And not you attempting to control Christ. It is impossible, as many pastors attend their congregants to be doing. In verse 16, he says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that disbelieveth shall be damned. This was where we said last week that we'll be treating baptism.
That's right.
Yes. We will go for the next 5 videos straight, all 5, and then we will explain our points.
As I promised, we have 5 videos to show this evening, and if production is ready, please, the 5 videos.
Accepted you.
I hope so.
This is a beautiful moment because you have chosen to follow Jesus and give your heart to Him 100%.
Yes.
And He has accepted you. I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You want to say anything?
Praise God. That's all I can say. Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
This probably isn't good, but I'm gonna check it anyways. Hear that hollow sound there like that? If you fall in the water here now and the current sweeps you under that ice and you're kissing the bottom of the ice, you're a goner. There's no way, you're done. There. No, this is a bad place here to cross. You see here, there's not even there's no ice. It's just snow. See that? Just snow and right, there's no ice. It's a snow bridge. I mean, there's no ice at all under there. there are some years that you can cross here, some years you can't. You just, every year varies, so you just got to check it, you know. But this year, obviously, it's not that good of a place to cross, so I'm not going to even mess with this area. Got to keep looking.
Come once again, we promised that we are going to talk about baptism this evening. And lucky enough, we've been able to watch some 5 videos. So we'll go to Evangelist for the explanation of the videos. Evangelist.
Yes, you're welcome. Talking about these videos, the very first one, that was baptism done in the river.
Okay.
Yes. See, the river was very calm and everything went on so nicely and smoothly. And then we saw the people or the candidates being immersed. Yes. And the immersion is done once.
Okay.
We will be explaining all these things as we make progress.
Okay.
And then there was another baptism also in the sea. Okay. We saw it, we watched it. Yes. And then there were other two. These were baptistries, you know, in the, let me say, in the church house.
Okay. Created in the church building.
Right. And all these qualifies the baptism. There's nothing wrong about the 4 baptisms that we have demonstrated. There's nothing wrong. What I have heard people saying, many have called to question, and I've been responding to, is that the water, as Christ said in John 3:5, when he said, unless a man is baptized by water, yes, whether it is the sea, water, swimming pool, water, whether it was a baptistry, water, it is not an obligation or it is not an instruction that we should be baptized only in a river.
Stream or in a river.
Yes, never. Christ said, unless a man is baptized by water.
So people believe that it is the water that washes away.
Yeah, the sins.
If the water is stagnant, it means the sin remains in there.
Yes, we will use Bible quotations to define that in a moment.
Okay.
But I want to assure them, those who be baptizing, some will be baptizing tomorrow. So our caller, some of us are going to the water tomorrow.
Okay.
And they have asked these similar questions. Please, you saw the 5th video where the river, it was a river that has been frozen by the weather, by snow.
That's right.
And you saw the man using the axe to break the ice until he gets to the water. Now, if you insist that you wanted to be baptized in a river, and you happen to be in a condition like that, where the climate and atmosphere is like that, you couldn't stand in that water for baptism.
No.
The moment you stepped in, you were frozen.
That's right.
And the next thing was, you know, for you to be buried. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
The blood will stop pumping because the whole body be frozen. And that will answer to your death. So if people in such areas and under similar circumstances have realized that, no, let us create a baptistry where there will be enough water that a person can be immersed in. When I'm using the word immersed, it's just a borrowed language from the Greek.
Okay.
Because, you know, with the word translated baptize is directly coming from the Greek they call baptizo, which means to immerse, to
dip
something under. Yeah, to dip something underwater or make something, you know, disappear.
Okay.
Right, underwater.
Completely covered by the water.
Because the Bible uses baptized by water. So you are covered by water completely.
Okay.
So that is the work, or that is how baptism is demonstrated. Now, let me come to the point you just made in a moment. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, in fact, the text will be flowing from here.
Okay.
1 John chapter 1, verse 7, it says, but if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sins.
Oh, okay.
So he didn't say the water, as people want us to understand. Never. It's not a business of water.
Okay.
Number 2, 1 Peter chapter 1, 18-19. 19 will tell you that, but with the blood, with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb, without blemish and without what? Spot. Why so? God in 18, he said that, for as much as you know that ye were not redeemed by corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by tradition from your fathers.
Okay.
But with the blood, with the precious blood of Christ. So this is the second text we are adding to 1 John. Mm-hmm. And then the third Bible text in Revelation chapter 1 verse 5 says, "And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth,
okay,
unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood."
That's right.
So why are the pastors saying that is the water that washes us?
Okay.
No. If the water has the efficacy to wash away our sins, then why the death of Christ? That's all. God could have sanctified.
That would be necessary.
God could have sanctified a body of water and everybody should go and jump in the water and then go scot-free. But this is not the case.
Okay.
Now, in Exodus chapter 12, verse 13, when they were exiting Mizraim, Exodus 12, 13 says, "And when I see the blood, I will pass over you." That is it. So it's the blood that cleanses us.
Okay.
So it is not the water. The water is the burial ground. According to Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4. In fact, the water is a symbol of the grave where Christ was buried.
That's right.
That's the purpose of the water. So the water is not for cleansing, as people want us to understand and to believe it.
And Jesus was buried once.
Jesus was buried once and he rose. In Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4, it says, "Know ye not." That means you shouldn't play ignorant here. You're supposed to know. That's why Paul is asking. "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?" So baptism is being buried with Christ. Verse 4. It says, "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life."
Oh, okay.
You see. So baptism by water means that you have believed in Jesus Christ and you believe in his death and his resurrection, and you are demonstrating that by the act of baptism.
Okay.
So whether it was swimming pool, the sea, fish pond, whatever body of water that was used to baptize you, it is serving as a grave. That's all.
We shouldn't use the water to sprinkle around you.
Never. Never. Or anything less than what we are reading now, okay, is not from the Bible.
The simple example has been set.
That was how Christ was baptized. We'll be getting there in a moment.
Okay.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 3. It says, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received." This is Paul. "How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." I like the statement there. "Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." Any scripture that does not have the death and resurrection of Christ according as it's stipulated, we don't accept that one as part of the body of the scriptures.
Okay.
Yes. I know people have been hiding under all scriptures given by the inspiration of God. Yes. That all scriptures, the parameters lies within the scriptures that accept Christ as the personal savior, and then Christ died and rose again.
That's right.
These are the scriptures we profess, or these are the scriptures we believe. Now in verse 4 he says, "And that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures."
That's right.
That is why in baptism we teach and it is a practice that Christ also left behind. You were deep in the water, immersed in, and then brought up.
That's right.
Finished. I've seen people going beyond that three times and more. Christ was buried once and he arose and never died again. So please bury your candidates once in the water and set them up. Finish.
Because some people are saying that he said, "Baptized in the name of the Father,
yes,
the Son, and of the Holy Spirit."
Mm-hmm.
So they dip you in one, in the name of the Father.
Yes.
We raise you, dip you again in the name of the Son, and then the third one will be in the name of the Son.
He says
the Holy Spirit.
He says, "Whatsoever ye ask, ask in my name." You understand? Yes. Because we have read in 2 Corinthians 5, 18, 19 that God was in Christ reconciling the world. So when he says Christ has said yes, baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, it's in Matthew 28, 18 down 20.
That's right.
He didn't say that baptism should be done one after the other, one name after the other. His was the example. And the examples we have had in scripture all through is that baptism is, you know, a demonstration of the burial of Christ.
Okay.
Unless they want to find a meaning to the burial of Christ and resurrection, that when Christ died, he arose, and then he died again the second time, arose, and then the third time arose. If they can establish it in the scripture, then their theology is okay.
Which is not in there.
Impossible. He says, I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive. That is Christ.
Okay.
So you are demonstrating faith in Christ. Now, Christ is standing before the throne of grace. We have managed to get a depiction or a drawing, an artist's impression of the ark.
That's right.
That's the throne of grace on the screen. And this is where Christ is standing. Now, after my baptism, anytime it happens that I sin, should I sin? There is no need to fear.
Okay.
Whatever sin I do is just the breaking of what is in the ark. And that is what Jehovah calls sin.
Okay.
So after my baptism, Christ has given me the assurance that he's given me strength to overcome.
That's right.
But should I fall, then it is his business now to take hold of me.
Mm-hmm.
Now when you look at the law in the ark, that is what is written in my heart. And in Deuteronomy chapter 6, beginning from the Old Testament era,
okay,
it says, verse 1, it says, now these are the commandments in plural, and the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that ye might do them in the land whither thou go to possess.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? It is in verse 5.
Mm.
And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and all thy might. This is Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5.
Okay. Meanwhile, the law is written on your mind,
yes,
and then on the heart.
Yes. Mm. Now, Christ responded to that in Matthew 22, 37. It's on the screen. Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is quoting from Deuteronomy 6, 5.
Oh, okay.
Simple.
So it's wasn't on the screen. A new law
at all
being initiated by Jesus.
At all.
But it was the old that he re-echoed.
This is where Christ is standing.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you read from Leviticus 19:18, it also tells the second part of the law. Thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
This is what is in Matthew 22:39. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So from day one, the law of God has been there. Now, I have been directing people to go to the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Okay.
And I still stand there. In fact, I want to plead with the other Sabbath churches. Many out of this program have joined them.
Okay.
Please, they should redirect the people that we are saying that they should join the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And my reasons are very simple. If you want a church now, as we stand or we sit, as you want a church now who believes in all the Bible, I'll point you to the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
That's right.
Period. Now, let me just pick from their logo. When you look at the logo of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the first item you see is the Bible.
That's right. That is in green.
Yes. The Sola Scriptura.
Okay.
And they have a set of beliefs. They call it Seventh-day Adventist Fundamental Beliefs.
Okay.
And the number one, there are 28 of them. The first out of the 28 reads, says the Holy Scriptures, Old and New Testaments, are the written word of God, given by divine inspiration. The inspired author spoke and wrote as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
Okay.
In this word, God has committed to humanity the knowledge necessary for salvation. The Holy Scriptures are the supreme authoritative and infallible revelation of his will. They are the standard of character, the test of Christian experience, the definitive revealer of doctrines, and the trustworthy record in God's acts of history.
Okay.
Understand? Now, the Seventh-day Adventist Church has come out boldly to say that the Bible is the definitive acts of God's word. I mean, when you want to define what is righteousness, what is true, what is doctrinal, based on the Bible.
That's right.
And I'm telling the rest of the churches that they have never equaled this. Use the Bible as a standard, as the Seventh-day Adventists have said, and take it to the churches, and you'll be knocking all of them out of the scripture, by one. Because there are man-made instructions in the institutions. Now, let me give them an example why I'm saying this. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 25,
okay,
it says, "And if thou would make me an altar of stone, thou shalt not build it of hewn stone. For if thou lift up thy tool upon it, thou hast what? Polluted it." Let me explain it.
Mm-hmm.
God is saying that if you want to make an altar,
okay,
to sacrifice, to pray, when you grab the stone, don't use a chisel or a hammer or an axe. Yes, to chop away any portion of it. Pick the stone like that, place it there. Pick it and place until you can build your altar.
Oh, okay.
The moment you hammer it or you put any tool upon it, you have polluted the whole tool.
Wow.
What am I suggesting? Mm-hmm. What am I telling them? According to Exodus chapter 20, verse 25, there should be nothing man-made in the setup. Our whole body is an offering we are presenting to the Lord. You understand?
Okay.
So that there shouldn't be any human alteration in what you are giving to the Lord. It should be a thus says the Lord. That's why I'm telling them that they should go to the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Okay.
Because it is a church that professes to stand on scripture. Mm-hmm. Yes, some of the members may not be correct,
mm-hmm,
per your view and what you have seen, but that is not, the members are not the fundamental beliefs.
That's right.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
They are based the institution on scripture. Let any church also come out with what I'm saying.
Okay.
We will proclaim them on
there. To use the Bible as the litmus paper to test for all faith.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they should tell us, mm-hmm, that their church is founded on scripture.
Okay.
And then proof. After saying it, they should give it the proof and we'll announce it quickly. So I'm saying that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. That's what the Adventist Church is teaching. And we are directing people that will go there tomorrow for baptism.
That's right.
Why so? Christ is standing before the ark. And where sins are confessed and where sins are forgiven.
Mm-hmm.
That's where Christ is standing at. And we are saying that sins, for us as human beings,
okay,
we cannot define sin. God defines what is sin and what is sinful.
Okay.
So that Christ standing before the ark, pleading for my sins, the moment I believe in him, he credits me his righteousness.
Okay.
It is not a matter of him confessing my sins only, but after blotting away my sins, it's a debit and credit.
Okay.
You understand?
Okay.
Yes. So when I sin, I am wearing a sinful garment now.
Okay.
Christ brushes away that garment,
mm-hmm,
and then he credits me his own righteousness.
Okay.
So that is what Jehovah sees on me.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't see me as a sinner.
Stand before the throne,
yes,
with the righteousness of Jesus Christ,
sure,
but not yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So when this is achieved, Galatians chapter 3, 27, 28, 29 says that, "For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ."
That's right.
There is neither Jew nor Greek, neither born nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ. I don't understand certain Christians. That's a scripture.
Okay.
They still hold on to this man is a Jew, that man is a Gentile, this man is a Jew. Where from all this? Now, in verse 29, it says, "And if ye be Christ, then ye are Abraham's seed."
That's right.
"And hers according to the promise." So if they are claiming Christ, that they are Christians, fine with me and fine with them. When you have claimed Christ, Christ takes you and gives you to Abraham. So you cannot say that you are remaining in Christ.
Because the promise was made through.
Yes.
Okay.
You understand? God said his descendants shall be like the stars of heaven. And we are not those 2x4 Israelis over there. They don't belong to the promise anymore.
Okay.
They have forfeited their promise. They know in themselves that
they believe in Jesus.
Exactly.
Christ.
As many of them that shall pass through Christ, they are welcome. But so long as they'll be there holding on to righteousness by works,
blagging to be heirs of the kingdom.
Oh, they should not boast of being biological Israelites. That they have forfeited the promise already.
Okay.
We are the genuine ones because Abraham is a man of faith.
That's right.
Yes. So, fellow Christians, when you believe in the Lord, he gives you to the family of Abraham. So that is where baptism leads us. Now, someone might ask for rebaptism. Yes, those of people who have called that, you have been baptized by immersion already.
That's right.
Please, you should go for baptism tomorrow or any time on the Sabbath. Visit the Sunday church for re-baptism if you want to.
Do we have Bible proof for that?
Yes.
Re-baptism. Being baptized twice by immersion.
According to the records or the account we have in Acts chapter 19, verse 1 to 5, there were a few Christians there gathered in the Corinthians where Paul was coming from. And then when he got to those Christians, he asked them concerning the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
If they have been gifted the gifts of the Holy Spirit, he said no, they have no idea of
what the Holy Spirit,
whatever it is. Then the question followed, then why did you baptize? Who baptized you? He said, we are baptized by John the Baptist.
Okay.
Then Paul explained the prophecies relating to John the Baptist, the prophecies relating to Jesus Christ, the prophecies relating to the Holy Spirit. Then they understood. The scripture says, when they have understood, Paul and his people baptized them again.
Okay. Based on the new understanding they've had.
Yes.
He baptized them once again.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So these are people who had been baptized by John the Baptist, the man who baptized Jesus Christ himself.
That's right.
These are people he had baptized. But when he came to understanding of certain doctrines, he saw that these people were bereft. They had no idea of it.
Okay.
And so having taught and gone through the teaching, it was necessary for them to be baptized. So they were baptized again.
So our brothers and sisters who are worshiping in the Sunday churches,
yes,
who have decided to join the Seventh-day Adventist church, it is not a sin to be re-baptized.
Yes. You can baptize more than twice, so long as you have not come to the knowledge of the light or the truth. Yes, you can baptize more than once,
okay,
or twice.
Okay.
Now, let me sum the whole thing. The post-baptismal life. I've been baptized now. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. He says, my little children, those things write I unto you, that ye sin not.
That's the main motive behind the letter.
Yes, now I have been baptized. So he said, this thing write I unto you that ye sin not. Then he followed up. If any man sin, that's a conditional statement. He did not say that go and sin. But should it happen, if, that's the word. If any man sin, he says what? We have Jesus Christ as our advocate. So after my baptism, I'm praying for the grace of God to sustain me.
Okay.
But you know, like Peter, who swore heaven and earth that everybody could deny Christ but not him.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't take long that a very small girl who came not even with knife or any weapon, just with some few words, Peter was able to deny Christ 3 times.
Okay.
Should it happen to any of you after baptism, please don't be scared. Just go and confess. That's why chapter 1 verse 9, 1 John says that if you confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Yes.
So that is it. And then the last of it, people use this man on the thief on the cross, that he wasn't baptized, therefore there is no need to be baptized. Now, as Christ stands before Jehovah, before the Ark of the Covenant, he gives us his righteousness. And in his righteousness, there is baptism. That's what we call imputed righteousness. The theologians will tell you justification by faith.
Okay.
So, whether baptized or not, the moment you believe, Christ gives you his righteousness.
Because maybe you don't have the opportunity to go and baptize.
Yes, you don't have. When you have been given that righteousness, then you demonstrate it through baptism. So, you have it already.
Okay.
So, when the thief confessed Christ on the cross, he was promised heaven. Right there on the cross, he was promised eternal life. And that promise comes with the reception of the righteousness of Christ.
That's right.
Which, you know, he has righteousness embedded in it. The righteousness of Christ
because
is
Jesus
induced.
Baptized,
yes,
not as a sinner
at all,
but rather for those people in that circumstance
who believe in him.
So
the baptism of Christ is infused in his righteousness.
Oh, okay.
And he gave it to the thief on the cross.
To God be the glory. So soon our time is up. I wanted to read some messages, but unfortunately the time is up. So our brothers and sisters who are going to be baptized tomorrow, we wish you all the best and say God bless you for taking such a bold decision. And as I said earlier, Evangelist and the team is coming to La North SDA Church tomorrow morning from 9 o'clock or 9:30 to 5 thereabout. So if you want to join the team, you can also come there. That's La North SDA Church for us to share the word together. And myself, I'm going to Kotoku SDA Church. Kotoku SDA Church. I'm going there tomorrow morning. So let's meet over there and then study or share the word. We thank you for making time this evening to also watch the program. We are still pleading with you. We need money, seriously. So you can contribute to support the program by sending your Momo to 055-3574-933. That's 055-3574-933. And the name that will appear is Evangelist Joseph Anani's name. And if you have any question with regard to the program, you can call the same number and Evangelist will be on standby to pick up your calls. So thank you for making it, watching the program this evening too. My name is Evangelist Kofi Kakari, and the man of God that God used this evening is Evangelist, the researcher, Joseph Anani. Evangelist, God bless you for making time.
Amen.
This evening too. So same time next week, we'll meet again. Don't forget, we will know the truth, and the truth shall set us free. God bless you.